Hello, friends, and welcome back to r/ProRevenge. And today we have two brand new crazy revenge stories for you. But before we begin, don't forget to subscribe to the channel and leave comments so we know what kind of stories you love the most. Oh my God, we're so sorry we blocked your doorway. Now go get your earmuffs. I've had a long, respectable career in game development. A couple years ago, I abandoned it for a cushy corporate job and now spend most of my days missing game dev. This story takes place about 10 years ago at the apex of my career. I was the lead on a AAA project. Our parent company, for which video games was just one of many lines of business, was going through changes. We had to move offices 3 times in 1 year. Second of the 3 moves, always intended to be temporary, put us into the basement of an older building long occupied by satellite departments not involved with development. The basement we were given had been empty for years, save for the most distant office. You entered the basement through a dimly lit staircase, then after you snaked through a horror movie-like maze of corridors and interconnected small rooms, you'd eventually arrive at the furthest room of all. A golden plaque was on the door. Trademark Compliance Department. Literally no one I knew was ever aware of trademark compliance, even though trademarks were a pretty important part of everything we did. The department consisted of a single elderly trademark attorney and his fresh-faced college grad assistant slash paralegal slash whatever. The lawyer flipped his friggin' crap when he learned people were being moved into his basement. For a couple weeks, he tried desperately to prevent the move, getting all the way to the CEO. The tiny, leathery lawyer amazed everyone with his deep, booming voice that would climb and climb and climb in pitch as he yelled and screamed and threatened. So all his efforts being for naught, our stuff was moved into the basement over 1 weekend. We spent the following Monday and Tuesday dealing with all sorts of setup woes, electrical outlets, network connections, breathable air. On Wednesday, 2 quiet 2D artists came into their L-shaped room, the one with the fancy door to trademark compliance, and found that all their stuff, chairs, desks, computers, everything was pushed into the far corner. A walkway of caution tape was set up leading to the compliance door. While we were trying to figure out what the hell happened, a demigod VP, as close to the company's CEO as it gets, walked into our lowly basement, trailed by the beaming lawyer. Apparently our desks blocked his door. He even had pictures. The demigod hadn't seen them prior to walking down. Once he saw dozens and dozens of close-ups of the desk corner, the VP's face grew less certain. Our desk was blocking his doorway by less than an inch on the side with the hinges. The door opened away from the desk. I'm guessing even when he opened it at 90 degrees, the edge of the door was about as wide as the protruding part of the desk. In other words, it was technically blocking the doorway, but no more so than the door itself. Non-committal as always, the demigod instructed us to make sure all pathways were clear at all times, and he expected this would be the last time he'd have to get involved. I'm generally a people pleaser. I can maybe even sympathize with an old guy freaking out when a gaggle of man-children in ironic t-shirts wreck his long-established way of life. I figured it was time to modify the seating chart. 2 people would be a pretty tight fit for that weird room, and I also didn't want my quiet flower child artists anywhere near that loon. I apologized to the lawyer and told him I was moving 2 people out and moving just 1 person in, making sure it was as uncluttered as possible. I had 2 potential candidates in mind, and while leaning strongly towards one, I considered a milder option in case the lawyer turned out to be an all-right guy after all. The lawyer answered my apology with a triumphant, "Serves you right," and "That's what you get for messing with adults," and "Welcome to the real world," and "This is far from over." He then ordered me to wait right here and came out with a tape measure. We snaked through his entire path from the staircase to his office, measuring clearance from desks and chairs and people's items, and the lawyer booped desks and monitors and garbage cans and pushed people sitting in chairs as if they were garbage cans. He crawled on the floor and marked out no man's land in chalk. No one was ever allowed to block his pathway, or he'd have everyone's jobs. Once the lines were drawn and the lawyer retreated to his fortress of smugness, I knew our slightly unhinged physics programmer with his anime posters and loud clank of his mechanical keyboard would not be moving to the room after all. My revenge was going pro. Now, the issue of sound was discussed more than any other as we were planning the temporary move. Our sound designer had to listen to all sorts of sounds at full volume on different types of speakers, not just on his headphones. If sound was designed on headphones and you played it on surround speakers, you'd sense it. Our old office had a professionally soundproofed room. And even then, that was a pretty unpleasant thing. Huge sounds could not be heard, but could be felt, like an inaudible earthquake. It struck you with primal dread. So we discussed this on and on and on. I wanted a soundproof room. Management wanted headphones. We eventually agreed on a compromise. We just have to accept screams and explosions on speakers while we were in the basement. This decision had also been made and approved by the same VP about a month before the walkway and chalk incident. You already see where I'm going with this. We made the walkway semi-permanent with construction tape. I took pictures and sent an update email to everyone reporting that A, we pledged to keep all pathways clear at all times, and B, the offending room would have the two girls move out and only have the sound designer move in. The VP replied with, "Thank you, that's great." See how the email listed the sound designer in an offhanded way? Yeah, this wasn't my first rodeo. We moved the sound designer and all his equipment into the room. Next morning, explosion started, then stopped. High-pitched screams in the distance. Footsteps. My door flew open and the lawyer ran in screaming, "What the F?" He dragged me across the street to the VP's office. VP wasn't there. Lawyer screamed and jumped and stomped his little feet, left voicemails, then retreated to write an email to the VP with CC list possibly going all the way up to President Obama and the Lord Commander of the Night's Watch. I quickly replied that, one, sound design issues had been exclusively discussed and were deemed a necessary evil. Two, I notified everyone before the fact that the sound designer was moving into that particular room. And three, if I had to keep moving people around every day, I wouldn't be able to hit my milestones. VP replied the next morning saying, "He's right about milestones. Besides, it's temporary anyway." And so, for the next 7 months, compliance department was subjected to 8 hours a day of nonstop explosions, gunfire, screams, grunts, engine roar, and wet thuds. Once released, our game sound was singled out for praise in multiple reviews. I put the lawyer's name somewhere in the midst of the thank you section in the credits. Putting the lawyer's name in the thank you section is a cherry on top. And our next story. Psycho and wife beater got what's due. I emigrated from the U.S. to the U.K. for work. A few other co-workers from the U.S. were also relocated. One of the other Americans that moved with the company had a real issue that I was 15 years his junior and had the same job. He would come to my house when I wasn't home, snoop through my home uninvited. He'd go through my mail. Several times, I was told he went through my email regularly as well. He was furious that we got the same company car and office size, etc. To give a little perspective on this guy, he had a tattoo of the company's slogan done on the back of his neck and seemed to really enjoy reporting any minor issue of his coworkers to the management. He was very easy to dislike. I started off small by making sure I got to work before him and taking his parking spot. I know how petty this sounds, but it truly bothered him deeply. But I started to wonder if it was worth the escalating battle of who could get to work first. But given the clear results, I kept it up. I would also send fake emails from my account to bait him. Like once I emailed my wife that we were getting a dog, it took him 2.2 seconds to run to our management and advise that we'd gotten a dog in a company leased house, which was a violation of policy. That was the fun stuff. Once we had a party for the American families for Thanksgiving at his house, before the party, my wife told me he regularly gets drunk and beats his wife. I didn't like the guy, but had no reason to believe this about him until that night. She had clearly been roughed up, and there were empty bottles everywhere. Apparently, he had a real anger issue. It manifested itself at work with a local UK employee, and security was called. I thought that was the end for him, but he scraped by. About a month later, a company security guard left a violation notice pad in the lunchroom, and I got an idea that worked far beyond my wildest dreams. The next day, I got a few friends to come in very early so we could take the whole front row of parking spots. The other spots were much further away. Needless to say, he was beside himself with anger. After about an hour, I went out and put a violation notice on his car for improper parking. When he left for the day and went to his car, I was watching from 5 floors up. I could see him turn red and explode in anger as he nearly sprinted to the guard shack and proceeded to physically assault the guard on duty. Police got involved, and this guy now has a violent offense on his record. It only took a few days for the company to see his true colors, fire him, and send him home. I'd heard a few months later that the wife, who was a lovely person, had moved on and was in a much happier relationship. And our last short story. Chef leaves with all his notes, almost kills the business. At the restaurant I used to work at, there was a chef who made the best gumbo I'd ever had. However, the management where I worked was awful. The only employees who stayed for very long were the ones who were paid well, e.g. Mr. Gumbo. Customers knew him by name. Then one day he called in sick, which he'd never done before, and they didn't let him. He'd had enough. He quit. But he also burned a few bridges. He took all his notes, which had ratios, spices, times, and temperatures, everything. We had no idea how to make his gumbo. They tasked me with recreating it. When it was nowhere near as good, most of the gumbo customers, which were a lot of them, left. I quit shortly after, and from what I heard from my friends who still work there, the business almost went under. This was his way of making the management pay. Edit. To start, we aren't in the South. This was a smaller place, but still a good size. The menu wasn't that big, so the gumbo was very important. The chef had every right to leave, but by doing so, the business lost its most valuable asset. That's how the gumbo man, chef, got back at the management. If someone who never calls out sick, they're sick. And you don't want someone that sick cooking food. Hey guys, thank you all for watching the video to the end, and I'll see you in the next one with more great stories with crazy people in them.